In this video, we are talking about Disney Game of Thrones. We are talking about JPEG, Iger. We're talking about Christine Wastelands McCarthy. There was a recent Wall Street Journal article that dropped just a few days ago with a ton of interesting information and tidbits. We're going to discuss it up next on OG 55. Welcome aboard, everybody, to another episode of OG 55. We have a fantastic show prepared for you today. We're talking all about that Wall Street Journal article. This, like I said, this corporate Game of Thrones. Fascinating, fascinating stuff. But before we do that, I want to introduce my producer, my good friend, my brother, my collaborator, Dr. Dre, Vast Guy, host of the Freshly Squeezed Show here on OG 55.
Dr. Dre, right? That's pretty cool. Thank you very much, sir. I do appreciate everything. And thank you for the excellent introduction. Yeah, we're going to be talking about that Wall Street Journal article. This is very interesting, peculiar timing on a Saturday. But hey, you know what? We couldn't pass this one up. I told everybody we're going to be talking about it on Monday. OG. Thank you for inviting me. So this is awesome. If anybody wants to go ahead and follow me, go do so on Twitter. It's right down there, at VashSky. As Christine Wastelands McCarthy would say,
for all the robust discussion, maybe I'll stab you in the back.
It's going to be, she's definitely part of this for sure. So we could be talking a lot about her. And if you want to see me, well, it's going to be on the channel you're watching right now, at Orange Grove 55, where you can catch great shows like the original Orange Grove 55, like you're watching right now, Citrus Corner, Orange Nerd, and my show as well, Freshly Squeezed, your source for juice, news, and info, squeezed fresh, right from the Grove. Okay, so this is the big one.
I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Dre, if you want to set the table, we'll kind of jump right in.
Yes. On December 17th, this article was posted by the Wall Street Journal. Bob Iger versus Bob Chapek inside the Disney coup. The former Walt Disney Company chief executive undermined and then succeeded the man that he had handpicked to lead the entertainment giant. This is a pretty juicy article. it's got a number of writers. Five? It's quite a lot, and it is long and beefy. We can't go over every single little thing in this. We're the channel that's done 40 minutes on grass, so yeah. We would love to go into every single little thing, but we definitely got to talk about the major points here. Going over all of this, we had been talking about this for some time. As this starts off right here, Bob Iger had been out of the Walt Disney Company for nearly a year, but as most people around him knew, he never really let go. Acting almost as a shadow CEO, he had undermined his successor and provided an ear for unhappy Disney executives, some of whom he had mentored. And also says this, if I can actually find it here. Let's see. Says, less well known is the depth and his antipathy and the lengths he went to deflate Mr. Chapek behind the scenes. OG, we have been talking about this for quite some time that, hey, look, this has definitely got Bob Iger's fingerprints all over it, right? That he's the guy undermining Chapek every step of the way. We had asserted before a lot of people did, I want to say, that Iger was the one pulling the strings. And it goes into detail on how that actually was occurring, maybe his top lieutenant, and how she was doing the bidding of Mr. Iger. But it was pretty clear to us that he had been involved, and this article pretty much confirms it.
Yeah, no, it does. It absolutely does. He was not happy. He was not happy with the moves that Chapek was making, and he was kind of behind the scenes you know, kind of trying to influence the industry and Hollywood and everyone to kind of get on board. Hey, you know, this guy Chapek isn't really pulling his weight. You know, and like you said, Dre, we've been talking about this on this channel for a long, long time. We were called, oh, you guys are crazy. Oh, conspiracy this, conspiracy that. It wasn't a conspiracy. Like, it's coming to light now that he was absolutely orchestrating this behind the scenes. You know, the Iger and his loyalists within the Hollywood trades and what have you. So, yeah, I mean, it's interesting. It's very, very interesting. Now the real question comes, you know, was this kind of planned from the beginning? Was this like a lot of people were saying, where, you know, he was going to have Chapek kind of be the fall guy to make these tough decisions after the pandemic and then kind of undercut him and then come in as a savior? Or was this something that was honestly he appointed Chapek and him and the board appointed Chapek to be CEO, and it was just organically as time went on, he would just became less and less impressed with Chapek's performance? That we still don't know, I guess, but yeah. I don't know. Yeah. It's pretty interesting, though.
We do know that the events surrounding Chapek and his foibles and so forth, and obviously Chapek definitely stepped into it. There ain't no question about that. But some of the things and the lengths at which it damaged him were definitely orchestrated, right? I think we all know that to be clear. As far as it going back as, you know, as far as 2019 and, you know, masterminding a whole plan that would play out of the course of 3 years, I don't know. Yeah. I really don't know. But look, listen, I mean, you know, that theory, you know, hasn't been more credible ever. True. You know, and especially after what happened in, you know, on November 20th with Chapek being ousted by Iger and how all that played out. I mean, it's definitely given that theory more credibility than it's ever had before. Now, we know that Chapek was being undermined, but it's interesting. This article even details about how he was being undermined in, like, smaller, subtle ways. And I wanted to go ahead and read you this one portion of it.
Yeah.
Bob Iger, then still under contract as executive chairman. Remember, this is when he passes the baton of CEO to Bob Chapek initially, but is still working at the company, right? He would work at the company for 2 or so years beyond that. He didn't even move out of his office that he kept at Disney's headquarters in Burbank, California. He called strategy meetings with Mr. Chapek's underlings without inviting the new CEO. Chapek told friends that Iger's attitude seemed to be, quote, "They work for me, not for you." Iger kept the CEO office. He didn't even give it over to Bob Chapek. So what does that say company-wide, especially within C-suite?
Yeah.
I mean, that is definitely a move there for sure.
That's a move. That really surprised me when I saw that. That really, really surprised me. That's a bad look for Chapek. That really does undercut him quite a bit. It makes him look like who is this guy? Like he doesn't even sit in the seat. Like, why am I listening to you? Right? Like, Iger still has a CEO. Oh, it's wild. Absolutely wild.
CEO in name only. I mean, right, it's quite interesting. Iger, 71 years old, felt slighted that Chapek didn't lean on him for advice. He told confidants that Chapek, 63, was doing a terrible job and that he was incompetent. Chapek struggled to find his footing. Iger hovered in the wings. It goes on to say, what is it? Other chief executives might have weathered the setbacks that Chapek incurred, but none had Mr. Iger breathing down their neck. So it details and goes on about how Iger was just, I mean, he was definitely, I mean, like they said, a shadow CEO type figure. Oh. And I think that extends not just from, you know, kind of a management leadership perspective, but I think it also goes into, like, definitely kind of pulling strings behind the scenes that we have been suggesting for a long time here.
Yeah, no, 100%. He was definitely pulling strings behind the scenes. And look, honestly, I can see why Chapek was a little mad about that, to say the least. I mean, I think that is kind of it's a big sign of honestly, just straight up, like, disrespect, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I could see why that got them off on the wrong foot. Absolutely.
Yes. And, you know, I think the Wall Street Journal has gone over how there was some disagreement regarding you know, firings at Disney initially early on in the pandemic, right, when the parks were closed. I guess Chapek wanted to go ahead and lay off some people before the CARES Act funding had actually taken effect. Bob Iger was like, no, we should wait. Iger made his case to the board. They eventually did wait, and Chapek felt undermined by that move. You know, he's basically saying that I'm not really in charge here. If you're going to defer to what Bob Iger, who isn't in the CEO seat, has to say, to that extent, I actually do agree with him. Maybe not so much on at what's at issue, of course, and definitely Wall Street Journal's characterization of that event, but. Chapek does make a point that he is the guy, or at least he was the guy. It's quite strange to have your predecessor overrule you in that regard.
Right, right. No, 100%, 100%. So now we're moving on to Christine Wastelines McCarthy, it appears, right. Huh?
Yes. And, you know, the article does make reference to her quite a bit. And I was telling OG before that this plays almost like a Christine Wastelands McCarthy puff piece in how it's presented and the kind of you know, specific facts that it brings out. It seems that a lot of the commentary provided to these journalists might have been provided by McCarthy or her camp itself.
Well, and here's the thing, and people might kind of interpret that as coming from a place of strength, but you can also interpret this as this puff piece coming from a place of vulnerability. It's very possible. Now, look, McCarthy backstabbed Bob Chapek, right? Real underhanded stuff, backstabbed him. Bob Iger has to be thinking in the back of his head, if she was willing to do that to Chapek, it could potentially come to me now, right? Like, I mean, why wouldn't it? It's very possible. It's like if you were to, you know, if a married woman cheats on her husband with you and you end up with that woman, it's always in the back of your mind. Like, if she was willing to cheat with me, she's probably willing to cheat on me. Right. And I think with McCarthy, I think that Iger is definitely keeping an eye over his shoulder, like, okay, well, she did it to the last guy, she might do it to me now, right? So that's very, very telling, I think. And I think that maybe this article is like, well, she's feeling vulnerable and she has to like kind of leverage herself out there in the public square a little bit, right?
I mean, it's definitely complimentary of McCarthy. The reasons as to why can certainly be debated, but OG, I think you make a great point. It does definitely It makes McCarthy look a little bit vulnerable, as if they're attempting to get across in the the court of public opinion that, you know, she's the gal and that, you know, her position should remain. Not only that, but she should be considered for the CEO position. You know, coming at a place of strength, you don't necessarily do that. Now, it is interesting. It is kind of fascinating this interchange between Iger and McCarthy. The bonds there might be closer than we realize. I have a clip from Valiant Renegade that, you know, kind of suggests, at least in their opinion, that there might be something going on between the two of them that, you know, maybe a lot of people aren't necessarily keying into at this moment. I want to go ahead and play you this. It's a little bit longer clip. It's kind of an exchange between Kamran Pasha, WW Pro, and Valiant Renegade. But it's a good clip. Trust me. Let me go ahead and give this a shot here, and we'll talk about it afterwards.
Sure.
McCarthy, the Disney CFO, was fed up with Chapek's performance. She turned to the one person she believed she could dislodge him. So what I was going to say specifically to that line is the fact that, like you said, Pro, blood in the water, who can I get in here that I can immediately rally the board of directors behind to do what I want to have done? I can't just say fire Chapek and not have somebody to put in there immediately. I have to have somebody that I can instantly get the board to rally behind and to agree to it. Who is that person going to be? Well, it's going to be the guy that I've been in communication with since he left in January, that's been communicating with all the studio heads, stirring the pot, because I know the board will gladly bring him back. Hello, Robert Iger. And what did we see in a story about a week or two after this happened? That Christine McCarthy herself is in one of the top three positions to take over as CEO of the Walt Disney Company in 2 years, when Robert Iger's two-year temporary position as CEO is expired. That Christine McCarthy
and there's
is
no
the top
reason
of the list.
For her to be on that list at all, because that's not how it works in Hollywood, right?
No, it isn't. So, how it works in Hollywood if somebody like Robert Iger gives her the papal blessing. And
no,
says
but
that
even
she
that,
will
he doesn't have. Let, he can give the paper, but he could have given the paper blessing to Iger, to Chapek. Chapek didn't have the relationships with the industry to manage that role. That's how he got ousted, right? He didn't have the ability. He didn't have the ability to go to James Cameron and schmooze Brad Pitt. He wasn't. Exactly. He was a manager of a major division of Disney, the parks, but he didn't have those social skills. This woman has no management ability aside from managing an accounting group.
Can you pause it just for a second? Yep. If you could pause it just for a second. Cameron Pasha makes a fantastic point. And I've said this before recently when they started floating her name around for the CEO. Christine McCarthy comes with a lot of the same baggage, and in some cases even more baggage than Bob Chapek. She's got no experience with Hollywood talent, which was a major downfall for Bob Chapek.
Right.
She's hated amongst fan circles. She's probably hated just as much in Hollywood circles too, I would imagine. She's very much a finance money person. And again, that's not inherently bad, but we went through this already with Bob Chapek. Why in the world would you even fire Bob Chapek if you're just going to have Christine McCarthy be the next CEO? You essentially are trading you're trading Chapek for pretty much the same kind of figure. So why even bother getting rid of Chapek in the first place? It makes no sense at all.
And we have made those arguments before on this show. Again, that was not only your argument, OG, but it was my argument as well. Like, hey, look, why are you trading out one financial person for another? This doesn't quite make sense. But it does speak to the question of, what runs a Disney company and who runs a Disney company? At the end of the day, they are a business. And who runs them right now? Well, I mean, obviously, you know, we look at the CEO position and all that kind of stuff. But you have to understand that these corporate investors, you know, people like Vanguard, people like BlackRock, people like Blackstone, are taking on a much more, they're taking on a more of a managerial role than they've ever had before, and that might be some of the parties involved, at least on the Wall Street end.
Right.
You know, that might be some of the parties involved that are part of this decision making process that maybe we hadn't previously considered.
Yeah, it would just make Iger look really bad, though, in my opinion, because what Iger's going out there, and he's made a lot of statements already since he came back on board, saying he really respects the creatives at the Walt Disney Company. He wants to nurture the creativity, and to say that, and then to have McCarthy come in, who's clearly not a creative, she's just as bad as Chapek in that regard, I think would do Iger some damage optically and in the industry. And that's what I think is one of the best for us as Disney fans. That's, I think, the firewall a little bit from preventing her, because I think Bob Iger would not be seen. I think he would take a lot of heat from creatives within his own company and even from Hollywood in general if he were to bring her on. And
I agree. I don't disagree with you, OG. I don't disagree with you. I'm going to let this play out here.
Wild.
Okay, we've had private conversations about how Iger's personnel choices not necessarily the best when looked at in hindsight. But I'll go ahead and play this for you. And again, maybe there are some bonds there between McCarthy and Iger that we don't realize. Maybe, like I said, maybe it's not completely Iger's choice to make.
I was going to say, you're right, Cameron. Investors. You're
but she's
right.
Not gonna, she's not schmoozing. She ain't schmoozing Scarlett Johansson.
She will be.
Ain't in those circles.
She will
even
be.
Less so than Chapek.
That's
my
point.
She's schmoozing Vanguard. She's schmoozing BlackRock.
That's it.
And they're going to contact ScarJo for you.
But
she's not in any way ever in line for this job in a normal circumstance. She wouldn't
be in a normal circumstance.
You're right. Wait, hang on. Time out. My point with this, Cameron, is that this is what this next 2 years is about, I think. If this turns out to be accurate and Christine McCarthy is then installed, crowned, knighted, whatever the hell you want to call it, as CEO of Disney at that point, then we will have known that Bob Iger has spent these last 2 years schooling her up, taking her around to the posh bougie lunches in Beverly Hills, having her meet everybody else, and turning her into a Hollywood acolyte.
Oh, no, they're trying that right now.
Yeah. So that's the kind of thing. Now, I'm not suggesting that's necessarily happening, but it is something to take note of and to consider when you're following these events as these things play out over the next 2 years.
Yeah. And one thing, speaking of like McCarthy and relationships, and I talked to you about this on the phone, and this really concerns me. I got to be completely honest. When I saw in this article that McCarthy was texting celebrity investor from CNBC, Jim Cramer, my antenna went up. And I'll tell you why. And a lot of people are going to poo-poo this, but hey, this is how I feel. You have a network, CNBC, that's very influential amongst Wall Street circles with investors, okay? Owned by Disney's direct competitor, Comcast Universal.
Yeah.
Okay, the network in and of itself, Jim Cramer aside, the network in and of itself should not, in my opinion, and I know they're within the law and they can do what they want, I get it. But in my opinion, I think the fact that this network is able to opine about Disney when they're a direct rival and possibly influence the stock price on what their celebrity investors are saying, I think should definitely be looked at the federal government. And I don't mean just Comcast doing this with CNBC. I'm talking Disney too. I don't think Disney, if they have a financial news network that, you know, like through the ABC brand, I don't think they should be sitting there doing the same thing, trying to influence and impact Comcast stock. I think it's like, look, it's like McDonald's executives telling the Burger King investors what they should do with their stock. It doesn't make any sense, right? It doesn't make any sense. So this Jim Cramer thing in this article, when I saw on there that he was texting the CFO of the Walt Disney Company, I'm sorry, that rubs me the wrong way. Jim Cramer has a vested interest in helping Comcast, their competitor. Why the hell is he having a say at all or any input at all into what Disney does? That makes me worried. And I'm sorry, that alone is enough for me to say, McCarthy, see ya.
I suppose, it's an interesting argument because I guess how I would look at it is, hey, look, if you just have casual commentary about what's going on, like let's say you run a news network and, you know, your news network is having casual commentary on all things news, you know, it would. To give you an example, let's say a rival news network had an anchor that was indicted and was arrested. And it was a big story around not only industry circles, but the local community and so forth, right? You'd be remiss not to at least comment on that somewhat, even if you were a rival, right? I think where it gets hairy is definitely financial advice. But beyond that, when you have this kind of communique with like anchors of this competing news network and you're putting stories out there that undermine the CEO of your company, that's really where it gets kind of hairy right there. And the article does make note of that there were some, I guess, texting exchanges between McCarthy and Jim Cramer around this time. And maybe those, calling for Chapek's head comments that Jim Cramer made, maybe those weren't as organic as we once thought.
Yeah, see, and that's what I'm saying. You get to a kind of a point here where it just feels really ethically sketchy. Okay. Like you have Cramer just like days before, I think, saying that Chapek should absolutely be fired. And then we find out that he was texting Christine McCarthy, and again, it's like, this is a guy who is employed. He gets a paycheck. He gets a paycheck from Disney's direct rival Comcast. It's like having the McDonald's executives, again, trying to tell investors what to do with their Burger King stock. It's not okay. It's absolutely not okay. This should not be happening.
I do obviously agree with you. I mean, if you look at this right here, on November 16th, Ms. McCarthy took matters into her own hands. Without having confronted her boss or seeking board approval, she called Mr. Iger to gauge his interest in returning as CEO. She caught Iger at a low point. He had been telling friends he was more concerned about over the direction of the company than ever. This is where Iger's inkling comes in, right? Yeah. Obviously, at that town hall that we just heard from Mr. Iger in his first kind of big public appearance, he said, oh, I had an inkling that I was going to get a call on November 18th from
Susan. That's why.
Oh, really? Interesting. Looks like Ms. McCarthy was the source for that. But to go back to your point there, took matters into her own hands. Apparently, nothing was off limits for Ms. McCarthy and you know, what she deemed was right for the company, or maybe right for her own self-interests regarding Chapek. Again, you know, speaking to somebody like Jim Cramer on CNBC, the article goes on to say that that day, November 18th, the day that Susan Arnold called Iger, Jim Cramer, who was a close contact of Ms. McCarthy's, said on CNBC that he had heard that Nelson Peltz, activist investor and Trian Fund Management LP co-founder, had taken a position in Disney. Quote, Disney needs his help. This current crew just isn't cutting it. Apparently, they were having text exchanges over the Q4 quarterly earnings reports, both before and after, it seems like, that, hey, these reports are going to be devastating, and how Chapek handled it was not the way that she wanted it to be handled. Apparently, the article goes on to say that, like, Ms. McCarthy was suggesting to Chapek that he should confront the issues with the $1.5 billion losses in their DTC division head on, and that Chapek failed to. And I guess she had grumblings about that and so forth, that she relayed about that to Cramer. And that's why Cramer made his comments. Again, it's
sketchy.
This is not making McCarthy look good, in my opinion. Now, she plays the corporate Game of Thrones well. I'm not saying that she doesn't, but
she's brilliant. She's brilliant. She's absolutely brilliant.
Absolutely. But she's her ruthlessness and her, callous. I mean, it's not necessarily CEO material, in my opinion.
Well, and does she even have to be the CEO? I mean, realistically, look what she pulled off here. She obviously has a lot of clout with the board. I mean, she pulled this whole thing off. I mean, does she even need to be the CEO? It seems like she has kind of her way around the company already. I mean, does she even have to be the CEO? I don't know. I mean,
I don't believe she has to necessarily be the CEO, not at all. But they're definitely, this article is definitely kind of geared towards McCarthy in kind of setting up this idea, I think, in the court of public opinion that she should be the CEO. Yeah. My question is, why the big push? You know, where is that actually coming from? Is it limited to McCarthy and her camp, or is it maybe Bob Iger approved? I'm actually not too sure. I never really considered that there'd be a linkage between there. Before I saw that Valiant, Valiant Renegade video, I was like, whoa, that's kind of a theory that I had not yet considered. Just to give you an idea of how pro McCarthy this is, it goes into her personal life, and how I guess she had a battle with cancer, and how she Miss McCarthy, 67, is known as a Disney devotee who, during a battle with cancer, often returned to the office straight from chemotherapy sessions. It also says that she was caring for her husband, who was in poor health, and that Chapek made some remarks saying that her attitude had changed or was affected because of that.
That's tacky, Chapek. That's tacky. I mean, she's dealing with her husband, terminally ill or whatever, and Chapek is like, you don't seem yourself. Yeah, of course she's not herself. She's going through all that shit.
I do question the veracity of those claims. I do question that a little bit. And the article does mention people who know Mr. Chapek said such language would be out of character for him.
Okay.
It seems like they're villainizing Chapek to kind of an it's to an astonishing degree in this article, and it's definitely from a pro McCarthy perspective. So I do kind of question that kind of stuff, but it does kind of go into like, it's going into this dynamic, including McCarthy in a way that no article has really done before. Also talks about her childhood and having her having suffered from anorexia, which I thought was particularly interesting.
I'm glad you brought that up, because this was, and look, this kind of points to, if McCarthy was behind this article, you know, to be fair, if, you know, speculating here, but that was actually a really smart optics move, because what's the one thing, and we've joked around about a lot here on the channel, Christine Wastelands McCarthy, what's the one thing that fans really dislike about her is that Wastelands comment she made about Park fans, right?
Yep.
Well, by inserting this into the article, saying that she once suffered from anorexia, it sort of cushions her, or it creates kind of like, what's the word for it? An excuse for her to make that comment. And what I mean by that is, it's like someone who has, you know, for example, mental health issues, right?
Right.
That person, it's more, they have more permission, so to speak, to kind of joke about mental health issues or something like that than someone who doesn't have mental health issues. Right. Mm-hmm. So, or it, let's say for example, like, you know, me, okay. You know, I can joke around about white guys with spiky hair and glasses, right? I'm a white guy with spiky hair and glasses. So of course I can joke around about it. So sure. With McCarthy, by saying she was anorexic, she kind of puts it out there like, you know, I can joke around about weight issues because I went through it. Right. I went through it, and it was, I think that's very much a on purpose, very much an optics move to sort of justify or make that Wastelands remark OK now, you know?
Oh, definitely presents a cloak of empathy that would have otherwise not existed over, like you said, OG, one of her comments that have been deeply criticized by fans and right. other people, attached to this kind of, industry-wide story. You know, it's definitely something that she's been criticized on. So this anorexia comment, it's definitely placed in there. Now, look, listen, you know, I'm still going to call her Christine Wastelands McCarthy because, in my opinion, it doesn't necessarily provide you the ability to disparage people, no. Especially your consumers and guests.
Absolutely not.
Part of paying your salary, let's be honest here.
Absolutely not.
In the way that she did, you know, it's a little bit of a protection of her personal fears or personal inhibitions. Like, I understand that, but it certainly doesn't. I think. Still doesn't give you that right. But it's interesting how they did include that. Particularly telling, for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And then it this is interesting too down here. It says, I guess Daddy Josh, it says here that as the environment inside Disney's C-suite worsened, more executives voiced concern in phone calls to Mr. Iger. Some worried Alan Bergman, the studio chief, and Josh D'Amaro, head of the parks division, might quit. Now, that line is interesting because there's been a lot of articles written recently that makes it kind of sound like Josh was directly saying, I'm going to quit right. because of Bob Chapek. And that's not true. According to at least this article, there were speculation amongst amongst company heads and executives that might be the case, that he might quit because of JPEG, but yeah. It doesn't appear that Josh was directly threatening to leave because of Bob JPEG. We got to clear that air a little bit, because that is simply not what this article is saying.
It's true. And it'd be like, OG, we've talked about how we're kind of worried that Jon Favreau might be, quitting Lucasfilm altogether, right. Going off to some rival studio and so forth, right? Well, if somebody writes an article based off what we say and says, oh, Jon Favreau are going to quit, according to, you know, that would be inaccurate reporting, right? It's kind right. of like what's happening here is that, you know, there are some people out there saying, oh, Josh D'Amaro was going to quit. And yet that isn't actually what's going on here. Now, I can understand where that fear may have been placed. I mean, there were a lot of people who, you know, felt that Josh D'Amaro was completely at odds with Chapek, and there was internal fighting and so forth, and that he's been pushing back, and, you know, maybe he was going to get fed up and quit. But to me, I don't know. I don't think that was necessarily the case. And while this provides more, let's say, credibility to that theory and that notion, it's not necessarily outright saying that Josh Giamaro was going to quit, that he just might, which is a lot different, like you said, OG.
No, it is. It's a lot different. And I got to say, I was wrong. I really thought, you know, I felt like Daddy Josh and Bob Chapek really felt like they were vibing. I really did feel like Josh really hitched his wagon to the Chapek horse, so to speak. And apparently not. Apparently there was quite a bit of tension between these two men, enough where there were rumors circulating that Josh was unhappy enough to maybe leave because of Chapek. So that's very, very interesting. Very, very interesting.
Oh, agreed. It's very interesting, and we'll see how that relationship between Josh Giamaro and Bob Iger blossoms in the coming years, because that's one to watch out for sure. I also want to go ahead and bring this up to you,
sure,
OG here. I guess Iger also told them that he was frustrated with the idleness of his post Disney life. Confidants around him. In early October, Iger had taken a trip aboard the Aquarius, his 150-foot yacht, around the Fijian Islands, and complained to friends that his wife, Willow Bay, too busy with her job as Dean of Communications and Journalism School at the University of Southern California, couldn't join him. It's interesting how they would include that, first of all. It kind of seems a little bit out there, but we have heard suggestions that it was Bob Iger's wife, Willow Bay, that was very much wanting him to retire, right? And it was one of the big factors behind his retirement in the first place, and how she may have influenced his contract being limited to 2 years for this next bout with Disney. What do you think about that?
I mean, okay, when I first heard the story that Willow wanted Bob to not like go back to Disney because to be home with the family, I respected that a great deal. I understand Willow's perspective. From what I understand, I think Bob Iger has kids and what have you. I can see Willow Bay's perspective of like, yeah, you should, hey, look, you know, retire and we'll just have some family time from now on. But my whole perspective on that changed when I found out that Willow Bay though is currently working. So it's like, okay, so she's working. So, but you're not allowing Bob to work? What's that about? That's a little strange to me. My whole perspective on the whole situation changed when I found that out. So I don't know. I mean, that's interesting.
That's a little weird because we had heard that, Willow Bay wants Iger to be with the family and so forth.
Right.
I don't want him working and all this kind of stuff. And yet she's working herself. That's just a little strange. I didn't previously know that Willow Bay was working at this time. You know, felt that her wanting Iger to leave, like I was sympathetic to the idea, but
yeah, absolutely.
Less sympathetic now that she's still working, but not wanting him to work. It's a very bizarre kind of back and forth there.
That's very strange to me. Yeah, that's very, very strange. So, and I'll be real, like, you know, like she, like you said, like she wanted him to do like 2 years. I don't know. I don't think the 2 years is going to happen. And I think even Valiant Renegade kind of alludes to that, right? In yes. that clip,
yep.
You know, I don't think it's going to, I think he's going to get extended. I really do. I think this is, he's got a lot on his plate right now between the streaming, the restructuring, and then finding a successor. I mean, that's a lot of work in two years.
That's huge. That's massive. I mean, it took, 6 years to kind of get Tom Staggs in a position to set him up for successor, and then that didn't obviously work out. You know, that was a long time. You're now going to, distill that process down to 2 years. I mean, that's a really big ask. Not only that, you're supposed to get this DTC division under control, restore relationships with both not only entertainment, but also with investors. As this article relays, you know, there have been some divestments from major mutual funds and so forth that really put Disney in a precarious position going forward. He's supposed to correct all of that within 2 years? That's a really big ask there. And just from the logistics alone, it would seem like he's going to be extended assuredly. Now, if he does, and if Willow Bay is actually serious that, you know, she's going to be calling up Giselle's divorce lawyer, it might be a really fun, interesting time within the courts of Los Angeles. within familiar courts around there and seeing how this actually plays out. But that's another story for another day, I suppose.
Yeah, and real quick, before I let you go, Dre's going to continue the party after I head out. But real quick before I go, I just want to say this too. CNBC actually released an article this year predicting this year in entertainment. I believe it's just entertainment. Like what could possibly happen? What could we possibly see in entertainment in 2023? And the reason why this article kind of caught fire this time around is because the last time they did this last year, they accurately predicted that Bob Iger would return in 2022, and he did. So people are taking the CNBC predictions article very seriously. One of the interesting predictions in this year's article is that they believe there's a possibility that Kevin Meyer and Tom Staggs return to the Walt Disney Company as like a co-CEO kind of
arrangement.
That would be fascinating. That would be really interesting. I would totally support that. I've been a big proponent of Tom Staggs. I think he would be phenomenal. Kevin Meyer, I actually really like Kevin as well. I mean, Kevin was really Bob Iger's right-hand man with a lot of these acquisitions through the years. Kevin's brilliant as well. He also set up the whole Disney Plus thing. He knows what he's doing. You know, he had a small kind of lapse in judgment when he got involved with TikTok. But hey, no one's perfect. No one's perfect.
exactly,
but,
right.
You know.
No, I do agree with that. The CNBC prediction article, I've been seeing that going around. I don't put too much stock in it. However, we did hear about how the board maybe not, wasn't necessarily all behind Chapek. The Wall Street Journal article relays that you know there were some within the board that kind of didn't feel that Chapek was necessarily the guy before giving him a unanimous vote for his contract, right? And that at that time we had also heard that Iger and Kevin Meyer were considered to be Tom Staggs and Kevin Meyer were considered to be candidates to replace Chapek in the form of maybe actually buying out Candle Media, bring them on board, and then make them co-CEOs in that position. I've also heard that the thing that kind of tripped that thing up, that arrangement up, was that Bob Chapek would have to sign off on the purchasing of Candle Media, so that didn't necessarily go through. But hey, if that idea is still popular, maybe we see Bob Iger make a move like that.
Yeah, no, 100%. And that's where I'm at. Like, as a fan, that's what I want. But who knows? And look, I'm rooting for Bob Iger in all of this. Because anytime anyone's running the company I love dearly, I want them to succeed. I felt the same way about Bob Chapek. I don't have to love Bob Chapek as a person, but if he's running Disney, I want him to kick major ass. And I want Bob Iger to kick major ass when it comes to restructuring all this stuff. I want him to kick major ass in finding the right CEO. So we'll see. I am rooting for him and the board to find this right person. The only thing that worries me is, like you said, Dre, we've talked a lot about it, like on the phone and what have you. Bob Iger doesn't have the best track record in picking people for certain positions.
Mm-hmm.
If you look back on some of his choices with this, not the great. Remember, Chapek was really a hand-picked successor. All the Hollywood trades were saying that. Hand-picked successor was Bob Chapek. And we know how that ended up, right?
Yeah,
So I'm a little nervous. I would be lying. I'm a little nervous. Hopefully, though, Bob Iger has learned some lessons from Chapek's appointment, and hopefully he's learned some lessons over the years. He's got a second shot at this, so let's hope he gets it done right, and we get someone really, really good in there. But Dre, I have to take off, but you're going to be flying solo. Thank you so much, brother. It was a lot of fun talking. This is a fantastic topic, but I'll kick it off to you, sir. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Dre's going to continue. I'll talk to everyone later.
Thank you, OG. I do appreciate it. Let me go ahead and send him off there. There we go, right there. OG, before you go, could you share my screen during the duration? Thank you. I much appreciate it, sir. Thank you so much for your commentary on on the forward of this video. I really do appreciate it. And again, I know that our fans are definitely looking for your commentary on this for sure, because this is super fascinating. And I will say, folks, this isn't the last time we've heard of we're going to be hearing from this article and talking about it. I'm sure we'll reference this more and more as time goes on. However, I wanted to go ahead and bring your attention to a couple of things I saw that I thought were most interesting here. The Wall Street Journal goes on to say an internal survey of Disney employees had found low morale. Look, listen, I Disney could have saved a lot of money on that survey. I could have told you that there was low morale within the company for sure. I guess they did do some internal polling, and that's what actually came up to it. But the article goes on. And according to a survey of consumer confidence by the Harris poll, which Iger followed closely, fans were falling out of love with the Disney brand. You know, it's interesting. We have been talking about this for some time now on this channel. A lot of people, you know, maybe they haven't necessarily, considered it or are talking about themselves, or maybe they're doing so, but maybe it's a very anecdotal from their perspective, the experience with others and so forth. But on this channel, we've been bringing up light some polls that haven't looked necessarily favorable towards popular support for Disney. And it's interesting how the Wall Street Journal actually brings this up. In fact, they actually go on and they include a graph here. They talk about the boos that Chapek received at D23 Expo. I thought that was very, very interesting. But you can see right here, the Disney's Harris poll reputation quotient right here. You can see that they're using a couple of metrics here: fair, good, very good, excellent, and it's graphed out by year. You can see, interestingly enough, how the polling for Disney actually goes down starting around 2017. Well, what big thing happened in 2017? Kind of interesting, because wasn't that the year that Last Jedi was released? I believe it was. Kind of interesting how it goes back to that with this kind of favorability survey or whatever. I'm not saying that was necessarily the thing that kind of dipped this down. I am saying that it's interesting to track these measurements along with the kind of company history at that point. But it has been going down for a while, but I will say that this decline had started actually with the Bob Iger era. Now, it dips into the very good and good over the course of the Chapek era, for sure. Ain't no question about that. But I just find that very interesting how what we've been saying on this channel for quite a while now, we actually have some data to back up that the consumer sentiment regarding Disney has definitely changed, and it's been affected by not just what is going on within C-suite, not just what with the certain statements by Disney CEOs and so forth, but also by the products that they're producing, by the services they're offering and so forth. Chapek defended the changes in a Wall Street Journal interview this year, saying that the leadership required, quote, the courage to do the right things, given all the forces that want legacy. This is going into how Chapek wanted to innovate, really kind of bring the company towards new directions that may have been perceived as controversial during the Iger era, and how, you basically had to have the courage to do those kind of things. Does that go in with the Axios Harris polls that we just talked about right now? I honestly think it does in some way. But in others, it could be debated, of course. I want to go ahead and just kind of go over this real fast. Between the end of 2021 and the summer, funds managed by Fidelity Investments had cut their Disney holdings by 30%, and the Sequoia Fund, Inc., a $5 billion mutual fund with about 46% of its assets in tech and media stocks, had sold its entire $2.8 million share position in Disney. Sequoia said in a letter to investors that proceeds from the Disney stock sales went to boost its position in Netflix, Disney's biggest streaming rival. So this article does air out some things that I myself didn't necessarily catch this entire time. I got to give credit to the Wall Street Journal for actually making this a part of their article. I guess you have these huge kind of mutual funds that are divesting themselves away from Disney already. I believe I had gone into the possibility that with Chapek's ouster might have included people like Vanguard, people like BlackRock pulling out of Disney as one of the justifications to actually get rid of Chapek, right? Maybe they were suggesting that if you don't get rid of this guy, we're going to divest our interests. Well, apparently that's already happened with some of these mutual funds. The idea that they would, you know, sell all their stock and buy up Netflix stock with it, that is absolutely concerning. That is not good. That is not good. The article even goes into the fact that Disney's investors consider the Disney's position right now as weak. You know, and it kind of provides a little bit, context that suggests that the urgency of the moment, basically, right? That this is a kind of a tough time for Disney. I understand people have their wish lists and so forth about, you know, what they want from Iger and all the big capital investments that could come for the Parks Division and so forth. But I think people really had to truly understand that this is a tough time for the Walt Disney Company. They're going through quite a bit right now. And even though it might not be immediately evident that their position is hurting, this article makes clear that that Iger kind of has a lot to do, and that some of his decisions and some of Chapek's decisions, he's really going to have to deal with these things going forward. That kind of rolls us into the kind of the park centric. Part of this article, since we are, a kind of parks oriented channel, I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about some of these things. Quote, cracks showed in the parks business, which for the past year had been Disney's most reliable moneymaker. Profit margins shrank in the fourth quarter. Bloggers and social media influencers amplified visitor complaints about rising ticket prices. Well, I gotta be honest. I guess that includes us, but c'est la vie. Market research by Disney found white visitors, 55 and older, souring on the parks because they viewed the company as quote too woke. I mean that's definitely a thing. For sure. I have heard from many people. I wouldn't say I would limit it just to white visitors 55 and older. I would say many of the people that I've interacted with have said that they don't necessarily like the changes that are going on in Disney right now. A lot of former employees who have recently quit are saying, hey, one of the reasons why I did was I didn't agree with necessarily what the company was doing. You can insinuate what that actually means and what they were actually talking about, but a lot of people have kind of been at odds with Disney's current direction regarding a host of things, not just their wokeness or whatever. Again, that consumer sentiment report that the surveys that are brought out by this article. I think that's definitely a thing, and I think that is hurting the margins regarding their products that they put out, whether it be their films, like we just saw with Strange World right now. It's poised to make only like $60 million at the box office, which is just a horrible showing for one of Disney's most illustrious studios. We've seen Pixar's Lightyear crash and burn at the box office there. And this article actually brings to light that you know, there are problems in Disney's theme park division as well. I guess Christine Wasons McCarthy said that, you know, that margins were shrinking, that business, you know, might be might not look so good in the upcoming quarters. And what are we seeing from Universal, even Universal Creative? They are paying out big golden parachutes to some of their senior top positions within that division. And according to Screenscape, they're doing it because they're seeing recessionary effects looming in the near future. We're also seeing the Fed increase interest rates and so forth. We're seeing Six Flags really being hurt right now. I mean, I think the industry at large here is going to be facing some very difficult times. Now it's kind of Bob Iger's issue to contend with some of those issues. The article goes on to say, the returning CEO, Iger, inherits a set of big problems. Empty rooms at the Disney theme parks, the long closures of Shanghai Disney and movie theaters in China, and Wall Street demands to see profits in the streaming division. On top of that, Iger has told the board that he has another focus, finding a successor again. Goes on to say, winning back disgruntled fans might be his easiest chore. I would agree. On a Saturday afternoon in December, Iger walked Main Street in Southern California's Disneyland, flanked by executives, his wife, and security guards wearing earpieces. Quote, "I love you," passing fans yelled. Some stopped for selfies and autographs. Mr. Iger looked ecstatic, leaving associates to wonder if he ever plans to leave. That's actually something that we said. Like, you know, that was definitely as some suggested actually in the chat with the following video that we made following that event, that it was kind of staged, right? That Bob Iger was making his kind of ceremonious grand return, public return, right? And doing it in a venue that was going to be most charitable and favorable to him. And the Wall Street Journal, well, they bring that incident out, interestingly enough. But yeah, there has been some questions on whether or not he will leave, as we've asked these questions not only here, but at the time. Like when we saw Iger glad handing it with Josh G. Morrow by his side, you kind of, you know, you look at that and you go, you know, Willow Bay is a little bit farther away from him than Josh G. Morrow in that frame. You know, where does his allegiance really lie here? You know, is it with his wife and what she wants, or is it with the company that he so dearly loves? And this article has said he can't let go. So kind of wanted to touch on those kind of few things there, because I thought they were kind of most interesting right there. I will say, yeah, with fans, probably doesn't have a problem. We'll see, though. I mean, even fans can sour if some of these things affecting the theme park situation right now regarding Genie Plus and so forth, or reservations. If that's not solved, I can see them souring on Iger and Josh G. Morrow a little bit. But we'll see if that actually materializes. We'll go over some other aspects of this article later. Like I said, it's a really, really long article. I recommend everybody kind of seek it out and read it for themselves. It's definitely worth a read for sure. Also, too, watch Valiant Renegade's recent video on his channel. There's some interesting commentary there for sure, afforded by the gang there, including Kamar Pasha. So definitely give them a watch. But for right now, hey, I want to go ahead and thank you, everybody, for watching. If you want to go ahead and find me, you can go ahead and do so right down there at Vash Sky, just like it's spelled. Just go ahead and type it into the old Twitter sphere, where we can have the most
robust
discussion, as Christine Wasons McCarthy would say. And if you want to see me, well, it's going to be on the channel you're watching right now at Orange Grove 55, at where you can find shows like Citrus Corner, Orange Grove 55, what you're watching right now. Am I Show Freshly Squeezed, your source for juice, news, and info, squeezed fresh right from the grove. So please go ahead and hit the like button if you like this video. Comment down below what you thought of all this. Are we spot on in our commentary? you know, is the article illuminate things that you didn't necessarily consider? Are we completely off base? You know, please comment down below. Let us know. And I believe that's about it. Thank you very much, folks. We will see you all later.